Good afternoon. I'm Betty Elliott, Interim Dean of University Extension at Iowa State University, and I'm pleased to welcome you to this Satellite News Conference. We're pleased to have a studio audience with us, and we're sure that there's a large audience throughout the state joining us at county and area extension offices and at other locations as well. This is indeed a historic event. The introduction of the first Vice Provost for Extension at Iowa State University. It's also an event many of us have been waiting for with great anticipation. So without further ado, I want to introduce to you the Provost of Iowa State University, Dr. Milton Glick.
Thank you for the introduction, Betty, but more important, thank you very much for the service you've given Iowa State generally over the years, but particularly in the last year. The job of interim anything is always a difficult one, and I think we would all agree that Betty has performed superbly and kept the ship afloat in the right direction. So we appreciate your efforts. As you're aware, this is, as Betty says, a major step for us. It's the appointment of the first Vice Provost for Extension. This is important because it represents the university's commitment that teaching, research, and extension are the tripart mission, that they need to be integrated and they need to be considered together. It's both symbolic and substantive, this new title. This search started roughly a year ago and was done by a 17-person committee. And I have to say it was one of the hardest working, most effective search committees I have had the pleasure to work with. It included extension faculty, non-extension faculty, extension staff, community leaders around the state, extension council members, and it was chaired most effectively by Associate Provost Edwin C. Lewis. So I want to congratulate the committee on an excellent job and thank them for their work. There were 67 candidates, or as we like to think of them, prospects in the pool. Six of them were interviewed on campus. Tapes were made of interviews, as many of you know, and those tapes were distributed to all 99 offices and were viewed by various constituencies, and we got much feedback, much positive feedback, I might say, about the candidates. There were also open forums, which were well attended both by university and community people, but also by the press. It's now my pleasure to introduce the first Vice Provost for Extension at ISU, Dr. Robert Anderson. Bob is a distinguished scientist and educator with a strong commitment to service and to outreach. He received all of his degrees from the University of Michigan at Ann Arbor. His PhD is in electrical engineering, as are his bachelor's and master's, and a second master's degree in physics. He spent 1967 to 1979 at Purdue University. During that time, he rose through the ranks to director of engineering continuing education and also to the position of the Ball Professor of Engineering. In 1979, he chose a new challenge to establish a new function at General Electric, where he has been since as manager of technical education at the corporate level. Bob, as you will soon learn, is a man of high energy, of high aspirations for extension, and one who wants to bring extension to a new role as well as maintaining the qualities that have made it a leading extension service since its inception as the first extension service in the nation. I'm very pleased to introduce the sixth director of extension, but the first to carry the title Vice Provost for Extension, Bob Anderson. Bob?
Thank you, Milton. It's a rare privilege to be the first Vice Provost of Extension at Iowa State University. And I feel singularly honored to be invited to accept that position. ISU has a rich heritage, a fine tradition, and I'm extraordinarily proud to become a part of all of that. I'm especially pleased to be given the opportunity to work with the ISU Extension staff and with all of the different university constituencies from all the different parts of the state. I'm excited and I'm eager to begin. I'm married. My wife Janice and I are looking forward to moving to Iowa. We feel as though we're coming home. We've been living in the Northeast in Connecticut for the last 11 years. We're having a house built here in Ames and it should be ready for us to move in early October. Janice will join me then or when we sell our place in Connecticut. What's attracted me away from my former position, which was a very good position, is the challenge that exists here. The challenge to be a part of the effort to create a new world-class model of excellence for university extension. My understanding is that the members of the Board of Regents want Iowa State University to become the best land-grant university in the United States. If ISU is to be the best land-grant university, then ISU must have the best extension activity of any university, of any land-grant school, for that matter, of any country. So we begin today to create first the vision and then the reality of the world's best university extension activity. And we set as our goal that by January 1, in the year 2000, Iowa State University will be known for having the finest university extension in existence at that time anywhere in the world. In the year 2000, people will routinely talk about the Iowa State University model for excellence in extension. Now, to develop the vision of a truly world-class activity, I invite the active participation of a broad cross-section of the university, the active participation of a broad cross-section of the citizens and the organizations of the state of Iowa. I invite every person in the state to share with me his or her ideas for how we can improve ISU extension. I personally intend to visit every county extension office in my first year here. I want to meet all the extension staff. I want to meet the community leaders in every Iowa town. I want to meet Iowa leaders in agriculture, in business, and in industry. I want to meet the faculty of Iowa State, of the other regents institutions, of the area community colleges, and of the independent colleges of the state. I want to listen to every person who has any suggestion to make for how we can improve ISU extension. I want a dialogue, a back and forth discussion with staff, alumni, and friends. I have a tremendous amount to learn about the current strengths of this organization. So again, I want to talk to as many people as I can. I want to learn from you, the people who know, where ISU extension is already at a world-class standard for excellence. Because as we innovate and as we experiment with new programs, with new clients, with new partners, with new delivery systems, and with new internal processes, we want to be very, very careful that we build on our current strengths and that we use our current strengths as the base to move forward, even as we build new areas of strength. I'll take just a minute to say a few words about how long all of this is going to take. To create a reasonably detailed vision of where we want to go, of what this new world-class standard of excellence in university extension will look like, to create the vision will take several months, maybe a year. Then, after we worked out the details of the vision, it will take all of us, working at our maximum level of energy and effectiveness, perhaps another 3 or 4 years, in order to move us some measurable, noticeable, significant difference along the path toward our vision. Then beyond that, we will need another 3 or 5 years to refine our vision, to move further along the path, and most importantly, to spread the good news of our accomplishments, so that finally, we will receive the recognition and the reputation for the excellence that by then we will deserve. The challenge that I'd like to set for all of us today is that by the 1st of January in the year 2000, we shall have formed our vision, we shall have translated that vision into a reality, we shall have proved and promulgated a whole new standard for university extension, a standard that will be the envy of every other extension activity, it will be the envy of every other state, and indeed, my expectation that it will be the envy of every other nation. I'm confident that with the good support, with the strong support of the citizens, the organizations around the state, working together with energy and enthusiasm, we can do this. So I ask for your help. Help us create the vision. Help us support and translate that vision into a reality. I invite your questions. I'll be happy to share with you the few things that I know, the few ideas that I have at this time. I'm very eager to begin to meet all of the people in the organization, all of the people around the state. I'm very anxious to begin learning the 10 million things that I need to learn about Extension, the university, and the state of Iowa. I'm ready for the first question.
While we're waiting for someone to come up front, we've had some questions phoned in already. Let me begin with the first question that was phoned in, Bob. What blend do you see of the research, teaching, and extension functions in relation to tenure and other university promotions?
One of the things that I said when I was here in the various interviews that I had was that at a land-grant school, teaching, research, and call it what you will, outreach, extension, service, have to be co-equal. And that's the theorem, that's the basis upon which everything else should follow. The corollary from that is that faculty are faculty are faculty, and that there should be one promotion and tenure criteria that would be applied to all faculty, all persons who carry the title faculty, and that criteria should be applied and balance the several different activities that individual faculty members have competence in, excellence in. Teaching, research, and service, it seems to me, go together, and that they can be most synergistic.
Here's another phoned-in question. How would you like to be perceived by the people of Iowa and by Extension staff? What words would you like people to use to describe you after they get to know you?
That's an excellent question. That's an excellent question. I was at a luncheon table earlier today, and the way I described myself was, I'm an odd duck. I'm not sure that that's the way I would like to be known around the state, however. In a more serious vein, I think I'd like to be known as a person who listens, as a person who's a quick study, as a person who is committed with every fiber of my being to making ISU Extension the world's best, a man who's fair, who's hardworking, who has extraordinarily high expectations for all of those with whom he comes in contact, especially those with whom he works, and a man who isn't afraid to have a little fun along the way, and who enjoys taking time out to smell the roses as well.
Here's another question. This was phoned in by Diane Weiland of Greenfield in Adair County. Iowa's rural areas have dwindled in population. Tax-supported services are usually based on population figures. What type of commitment regarding extension services do you have for these sparsely populated areas of Iowa?
I'm pretty ignorant of the details that would be necessary to answer that question with any specificity. But generally, let me say that I am biased in the direction of maintaining as strong an extension presence as we can in every county of the state. And that the expectation that I have is that extension will serve every part of the state, regardless of whether it has a large population or a small population.
Another question. I'll take this one personally. I mean, I won't. I'll take it personal. I'll let you take it. Do you have support from Dr. Glick and President Eaton that extension is equally as important as teaching and research?
Yes. Now, let me elaborate just a bit on that. Again, one of the reasons that I was attracted to this place, and one of the reasons that I left my former situation, is because this institution at this point in time, I think, is an extraordinarily unusual, and unique is exactly the right word, a unique place. The President and the Provost support the tripartite mission of a land-grant school, and I believe they support it both philosophically, and I believe that they're prepared to support it pragmatically. I have spoken at length with each of the deans of the colleges. I'm convinced that there is extraordinarily strong, above and beyond the usual expectation, strong support among the deans for a tripartite approach to their activity within their colleges. I think the support of the administration around here is just superb. And then when I hear about the regents wanting this place to be the best land-grant university going, I think everything is very, very positive for Extension to be able to achieve that world-class standard.
How soon can we expect to see some permanent people in all of the interim positions, such as Cirrus and the three program leader slots?
Again, I don't have a specific answer to that. My understanding is that there are searches underway for two of those three positions, and that the expectation I have at the moment is that those searches would go forward in their normal course, and that they would result in the identification and the ultimate appointment of some permanent position, person for that position. It's going to take us some time to figure out just what this vision is and just what direction we want to go. So we don't want to be in a hurry to add people who have narrow specialist expertise. We want to be, I think, at this juncture, more interested in looking for people who are broadly capable and who have exhibited, both in their experience and in their expectations for the future, an interest in being flexible, an interest in being a part of doing something new and different. So my expectation is we'll go forward with the searches that are underway now, and that we'll try to get things as permanent as we can, as quickly as we can.
There are a number of different questions here, Bob, all related to the community colleges, some directed particularly at agriculture programs in the community colleges, some more general as to the relation you see for Extension, particularly, and the university in general with the community colleges. Could you comment on that?
Sure. That's a good question. Let me enlarge the question, if I may, just a little bit, to talk about what should be the university's or Extension's relationship with other institutions of higher education in the state of Iowa. That would include, to broaden the question, the other regents' institutions, as well as the independent colleges that exist within the state, and it, of course, include the area community colleges. I think we're all here to serve the needs of Iowa, to serve the needs of young people, middle-aged people, and old people in the best way we can. Each institution has its own unique set of strengths, its own set of opportunities to provide service. I think what we're going to find is that in this more complex world in which we live, that we need to be more creative about forging partnerships, about forging alliances, about finding ways to combine the individual strengths of individual organizations in order to more effectively and more economically, in some cases, meet the needs of the people. So I don't have the specifics of how these relationships might look, but the expectation I have is that we will be forming partnerships and alliances, and that we will be trying to conserve total resources to better meet the needs of the people of the state.
Will you be co-op director yourself, or have someone else do that?
In the short term, I'll be the co-op director myself. Again, it'll take us several months, maybe a year, to work out this vision. It might turn out that in the vision that we work out, it would be appropriate for the director of the Cooperative Extension Service to be a separate person, separate and distinct from the Vice Provost for Extension. But at this point in time, I don't know that. At this point in time, I will reserve for myself that directorship and carry both titles. So we'll see how it works out.
This is meant to be an easy question. When do you begin?
I come on the ISU payroll on the 1st of August and expect to be physically present here either on that day or shortly thereafter.
Do you see your lack of an agricultural background as an advantage or a disadvantage in this role?
My lack of an agricultural background, I think, is one of those neutral kinds of things. What I bring to the table are people skills and organizational skills. I bring energy and drive for creating something new. So in a sense, my naivete and my ignorance might be viewed as an advantage. On the other hand, my naivete and my ignorance means that I'm going to have to rely more heavily on those experts on my staff and those experts around the state to make sure that we don't mess up something that's already very good, to make sure that we identify the areas of strength and that we use those as basis for growth.
Will ISU be able to do anything to help the farmers with crop damage from the recent heavy rains?
I don't know the answer to that, but one of the things that I learned when I was here interviewing was how well the Extension Service performed during the farm crisis era, early and middle 80s. As I read the newspapers about the flooding in the state, as I came into Des Moines last night in a driving rainstorm and got soaked going out to my rental car, that thought occurred to me that isn't there something that Extension should be doing now to help those who are suffering loss as a result of all of the flooding? I don't know the answer to that. There may already be programs underway that I'm just not aware of.
Just to add to that, Bob, I think you would have been very proud of the role Extension played during the droughts of the last 2 years, where the hotline served many of the farmers to make decisions, and I think we all took great pride in the important role they played. What do you see as the important new communications and program delivery systems for the future of ISU Extension?
Well, this system, again, one of the unique features of this system is that you already have in place a whole set of technologies that are there waiting to be used, maybe more, maybe slightly differently. The television system that we're using this afternoon is a classic example of that. My understanding is that there's also a computer network that links all of the offices together. My understanding is that the state of Iowa is putting in a fiber optic network to connect public buildings. These are the kinds of technological infrastructure, these are the roads and canals of the information age, if you will, that we just need to be experimenting with and trying out different ideas. And when we find some things that work for certain kinds of situations, then explode our activity in that area, but use it to the hilt. So television, for sure, computers, for sure. Who knows what will be invented tomorrow in this age in which we live? But we're going to keep our eyes open.
What will be the role of Betty Elliott in the new administration?
I think I have all of the bases cleared to make that as an announcement. We have invited Betty Elliott to take the position of Associate Vice Provost for Extension. And the role that Betty will play will be, if I can use a business jargon term, as Chief Operating Officer for Extension. My sense is that I need, in my first several months on the job, time to listen to people, time to get out and visit the people around the state, time to learn about the people in Extension, time to learn about the programs in Extension. My sense is that just keeping the store running in Extension is a major effort. Betty has been doing that job superbly well for the last, 2 years?
One year.
One and a half. And every report that I've gotten says that Betty has done a superb job in that role. I have been talking with Betty about this. I'm extraordinarily pleased that she's willing to accept this role. And I'm very much looking forward to working very, very closely with Betty over the next year.
What do you see as Extension's response to animal rights activists?
I'm really pretty ignorant about animal rights as a movement. I read the newspapers the same as most of you, and I just really don't know what the issues are in that area. Clearly, it's probably more important here in Iowa than it is in Connecticut, although some strange things happen in Connecticut from time to time. That's one of those issues, Milton, that I don't have any data on. I'm really so ignorant that I just need some time to study that one.
We have several questions that are similar, asking, what will the focus of Extension be, rural or urban?
That's almost like, when did you stop beating your wife? I don't see it as an either or. I see it as a both and. The caricature that I carry in my mind of Extension circa 1920, circa 1930, is that it was rural society focused. And the image, albeit vague and hazy, that I have for Extension in the 21st century is that Extension is much more eclectic, it's much more universal in its outreach. And indeed, as our society has urbanized over the last 60, 80, 100 years, Extension needs to urbanize as well. It doesn't mean we're going to give up anything in the rural areas. It means we're going to add some things in the urban areas. What the balance is going to be and what the programs are going to be, that's part of what we have to work out.
What are your views on staff development and individual professional development?
I am very strong on staff development. One of the, quote, rules that I put in place in my own organization in General Electric several years ago was that every individual in my organization in GE is expected to have a formal learning experience every year. That I believe in developing people, I believe in stretching people, I believe in giving people new kinds of work assignments that allow them to develop latent skills or to develop new skills. One of the hallmarks of Extension, I think, over the next several years will be the enormous opportunity that everyone in the system is going to have to learn new things and acquire new skills.
This question, Bob, will remind you you're back in the public arena instead of the private arena. What will your salary be?
Well, as I understand it, there's a book that's published that does list all of the salaries. And so, while it's clearly not my style to go around telling people what my salary is, my salary, as I understand it, Milton, you're my boss, will be $108,000 a year.
How do you see the current Extension strategic plan working with your vision of the future?
I have only glanced at the current strategic plan, and to be honest with you, I haven't studied it well enough to know exactly what it says, on the one hand. On the other hand, I don't know exactly what my vision is. So now I have two unknowns, and to compare two unknowns is the only thing I can say is, I don't know.
Yeah. Are there any more questions from the audience? We've run out of questions both from the local audience and also from the television audience. If not, this has been a superb opportunity for us to give you a chance throughout the state to get to know Bob, to get your first insight into what he thinks. And I know that he's looking forward to being with you in person around the state as well as through the electronic media. We are enthusiastic, the university, in your joining us, Bob. We are optimistic that you will bring excitement to not just to Extension but to the whole university and enhance our entire land grant mission. And so I want to close by thanking you for making a special flight out here from Connecticut just for the day so that you could be part of announcing to the entire state your new appointment, and also once more thank Betty for being with us today, but also for providing the kind of leadership she has and will continue to provide. Thank you very much, folks.